If you're new here, my name is Shelly and I am obsessed with all things true crime and serial killers and conspiracy theories and all of that type of thing. If you enjoy that type of content, then stick around and join the fun. Not really fun because most of the time people are dying. Anyways, today we will be talking about the serial killer named Jolly Jane. And this lady definitely needs some work. Let's get into it. Jane was born March 31st, 1854 in Boston. She was actually born with the name Honora Kelly. I think that's how you pronounce it. It's like H-O-N-O-R-A, like the word honor. So I think the H is silent because you don't say honor, honora. I think it's honora. And just to give you a little bit of a background on her, her parents were immigrants from Ireland. And in the 1800s, people did not like the Irish. In stores, there would be signs that said help wanted and Irish need not apply. People were just very mean to Irish people during this time. So you can only imagine like what her parents were dealing with being directly from Ireland, and then they came over and they started a family. They ended up having 4 daughters, and Honora, or Jane, I'm going to be calling her Jane, but at this time she's going by Honora. But Jane is the youngest, and when Jane is only 1 year old, her mother dies of tuberculosis. And there's not really much about the mother. Her name was Bridget, and yeah, all it says is that she died when Jane was very young. So her father's name was Peter, and he was an alcoholic. He actually had the nickname Kelly the Crack because his last name was Kelly and crack is in crack pot. This guy was just mentally unfit to take care of 4 little girls, I guess you could say. So he worked as a tailor, and one day he actually lost his marbles and sewed his eyelids shut. So there's that. Also, I feel like I need to start putting disclaimers on my video, but I don't think that I should have to, because if serial killer is in the title and you don't like watching serial killers, then don't watch it. You would think people wouldn't. So disclaimer, a lot of people die. So if you are sensitive to that kind of thing, probably just wanna not watch this video. So good old Peter was not doing a good job being a father. So Peter was actually, he was being made to go to a home to be taken care of because he had mental issues. So he ended up dropping off Jane and her older sister Delia because they were the youngest, and Delia was 8 at the time and Jane was 6 years old at this time, and he drops them off at a home called the Boston Female Asylum, and it was an orphanage. And whenever the staff would get new children, they would make a file. Obviously, I feel like back then keeping record wasn't as much of a thing as it is now. This place was good and they did keep record, but in their file when they were dropped off, it was noted that the girls came from a really bad home life. There's no telling how the father was, if he was an alcoholic. There's not much information, but you can use your imagination and kind of get the feel for what their life was like. And that was in 1863 when he dropped them off. I don't know if you need to know that, but there you go. So the people that worked at the asylum or the orphanage, taking care of all of the kids, whenever the kids reached the age 10, they would try to find a home for them or just kind of kick them out. Delia actually ended up becoming a sex worker, and she was actually murdered on the job. There's not much information, but that's really sad. Just a little tidbit I thought that I would throw in there. So here's Jane. She's at this home. She doesn't have any of her older sisters. Her mom has died. Her dad is marbleless. And she's getting close to aging out of this asylum or orphanage place. And that's when a lady named Mrs. Anne Toppin comes in. Now, Mrs. Ann Toppin came to the orphanage to find a servant. Isn't that great? This lady really wanted a servant and was like, oh, an orphanage would be a great place to find one. So Anne goes to this orphanage and she finds Jane and ends up taking Jane home to work for her and her family, do things around the house. The family actually takes pretty good care of Jane, but they do remind her any chance that they can get that she's Irish and how everyone looks down on Irish people at this time. And they also had a daughter named Elizabeth who was around Jane's age, and they actually got along pretty well. It wasn't like they treated Jane like a slave. They were basically like, you're Irish, so you can't get a job anywhere because people would not hire Irish people at this time. And so they would basically remind her how lucky she was to work for them and that they were taking care of her and that kind of thing. Yeah, they took care of her, but when it comes with people constantly reminding you what people think of you, it's like not a great predicament to be in, you know? The family would always be telling her, be grateful that they are providing this type of life for her, even though she was basically their servant. They even told people that she was Italian. They didn't even tell people that she was Irish. Now remember, her parents came here and she was born and raised in Boston, so she didn't have like an Irish accent or anything. I guess maybe she could come off as Italian. I don't know, but these people definitely tried to have her come off as Italian. And they would tell people that her family was lost at sea. As a teenager, Jane was well liked and she was very trusted by everyone. She was described as a good party guest, which I guess back then there's like bad party guests and good party guests, and I guess she was a good party guest. That's how they rated people, I guess. She actually babysat for all of the neighbors. Everyone trusted her with their children. She told great stories at these parties. One of her stories was that her father was a sailor, and another one of her stories was that her sister married a super rich nobleman overseas. And another one of her stories, she said that her brother was decorated at Gettysburg by Abraham Lincoln. She didn't even have a brother. So at school, Jane would stir up some gossip, and she even got some of her classmates expelled. It would just be her making up stuff about people. It wasn't even true. She would just make stuff up, and then they would get in trouble. Whenever the principal or whoever would try to find the source of whatever rumor was going around, it would always end up with Jane, because Jane was the one that started it. But anytime she would get in trouble or get into the principal's office, she would always lie her way through it. She was really good at like talking herself out of things. She was basically super manipulative. So she would mess with her classmates, turn them against each other, make up stuff about them, get them in trouble, and she would always get away with it. So at 18 years old, Jane graduated, and the Toppins actually freed her from her indenture and then gave her $50 to go off wherever she was planning on going. It was like a thanks for working for us all this time, bye. She actually ended up just staying there, and I don't really blame her for staying there because it was like the only home that she knew, and she closer to Elizabeth, and I think Elizabeth was like her only friend, even though Jane was definitely jealous of Elizabeth because she's born into this pretty wealthy family back then, and Jane was an orphan. But you know, I mean, they still kind of got along. But Elizabeth ended up taking over the house whenever her parents died, and she married a church deacon, and it wasn't until like 20 years later that Jane finally moved out. Some sources said that they got into a dispute, or there's some type of strain that kind of forced Jane to leave. In 1885 to 1887, Jane started training to be a nurse. She was 33 years old, and she was working at Cambridge Hospital. So it was noted that Jane was a pretty strong woman, And she was able to like lift patients. You know, whenever you're a nurse, you have to like lift them and help patients move because most of these patients can't do a lot for themselves. Her coworkers knew her as super helpful. She was very charming. She was always laughing. She was always making everyone else laugh, which is how she got her nickname, Jolly Jane. And the patients loved her. Her coworkers loved her. Her life was going great. She was thriving. I don't know how Jane got into giving the patients morphine and stuff. Like, I know that she was a nurse and nurses do that, but I don't know if she like gave a patient morphine and then she liked it, so she kept doing it, or she learned about the effects of it and then wanted to study that and was completely intrigued by it. I don't know how her obsession started. Jane definitely misused morphine on her patients. She was intrigued by the effect that it had on them. She used her patients as guinea pigs and mixed up certain concoctions with pain medicine and whatever meds she had access to, basically just to see what would happen and what effect it had on them. Her favorite thing to do was to use morphine and atropine to make the patient, it would make them go to sleep, but if she did it a certain way or whatever amount, like she experimented and she figured out the perfect amounts of each to give them to make them kind of paralyzed, where they can't move their body, but they know everything that's going on. And that was like her favorite thing to do, apparently. So she made fake medical charts and she was able to spend a lot of alone time with these patients. And back then, whenever a nurse was taking care of someone and they were injecting whatever meds they were taking, the nurse would stand there for a few minutes just to kind of make sure that the patient was okay. So whenever she would give these patients the medicine or whatever concoction she came up with, she would be standing there watching them, and no one thought that it was weird or crazy because that's just kind of what the nurses had to do back then. She would make her patients drift in and out of consciousness. Sometimes while they were unconscious, she would actually sexually abuse them, which is terrible. There was a patient named Amelia Finney. She thought that she had remembered Jane drugging her, like being drugged and like waking up and Jane was kissing her all over. Whenever she kind of got out of that, she just decided and told herself that it was just a dream because Jane would never do that, because all the patients, everyone loved her, her reputation. She convinced herself that it was just a dream. But it wasn't until later, when Jane was arrested, that she kind of put it all together and figured out what actually happened. So no one caught on to anything that she was doing. The only thing that the doctors were concerned about was she had an obsession with autopsies and she would always want to watch them or do them or whatever. I don't know the details, but for a minute the doctors were kind of worried because she was obsessed with the autopsies. But the doctors didn't do anything about it because why would they? She's a nurse taking care of these patients. She's reputation was just so good. She was Jolly Jane, for crying out loud. Why would she ever do anything like that? She would give the medication through injection, or she would put it in their drinks, or she would do it by an enema. So for obvious reasons, the patients that she took care of would sometimes die on her. Basically, whenever she was killing a patient, she would get in bed with them and she would cuddle them. It's weird. So this person is laying there dying and she would be cuddling with them and like comforting them, and she would whisper soothing things into their ear. Jane was recommended for the prestigious Massachusetts General Hospital in 1889. Now, the doctors that she worked with, they were like, she is one of our best nurses. She is just great. She's amazing at her job. All of the people that she worked with and took care of were older people, which is another reason why no one really suspected anything, because they were really old, and back then it was so common to lose a patient. Even if you had people around the clock taking care of them. It was just, I mean, this is the 1800s. They didn't know as much as we know today. So whenever she moved on to the Massachusetts General Hospital, she was actually fired from that job for being irresponsible. When taking care of her patients, she would give the wrong amounts of drugs, and people thought that she was just making a mistake, but honestly, it was all probably just on purpose, just her experimenting more. She returned to Cambridge, the hospital that she was originally working at and the hospital that she trained at, and she was fired for administering opiates recklessly. So the doctors that she worked with, I mean, they still thought that she was a great nurse because they worked with her for a couple of years. And I mean, it's Jolly Jane. I mean, golly, she's just a great person. She would never hurt anyone. So the doctors would recommend her to their wealthy patients to be a private nurse for them. So she would be able to go to these elderly people's houses and have a lot of really alone time. There was no one around. It was just her and her victim at their house. And yeah, so you can only imagine how many people she was able to kill or experiment with. I did see one source that said outside of her job, she guzzled beer and told dirty jokes. Is this about me? I'm kidding. I don't even like beer. She liked to turn her friends on each other, which honestly, I feel like we've all kind of known a girl like that. They just make up stuff and they like to turn people against each other. You know, just the kind of manipulative thing, it really gets under my skin. But Jane was a mastermind at it and she loved to do it. Jane was actually really successful at this time. I mean, doctors were recommending her to be a private nurse and she was kind of thriving. She could kill people all the time and get away with it. But she actually, I had one source that said that she earned $25 a week. Back then, the average income for a woman was $5 a week. So she was making, what is that, like five times the amount of another woman? Like, that's insane. She was making hella bank. She actually befriended her elderly landlord. His name was Israel. And shockingly, Israel died shortly after she started taking care of him, and she moved in with his wife, who was now a widow. Jane was probably like, oh my god, your husband just died. I'm so sorry. It's a good thing I'm here. I can take care of you. I can make sure you have all that you need. And 2 years later, she killed this woman too. And this woman, her name was Lovey, and I just think that's such a cute little name. It's so cute, but sadly, Jane killed her. And later on, whenever she was arrested, her colleagues would say that they remembered her saying how there's no use in keeping old people alive. So I really think that she just killed as many old people that she could. Back at Cambridge, a 70-year-old woman named Mary fell ill on a visit to Cambridge, and one of the doctors that worked there knew Jane, and they were like, hey, let me send you to Jane. She can take care of you. She's one of my best nurses. And Jane killed her. I don't know. There's not very many details. She just like fell sick and the doctor sent her to Jane and she died shortly after. Jane also had a friend who was the dining hall matron at St. John's Theological School in Cambridge, and she wanted this girl's job. So even though she was her friend, she still killed this girl and got her job. I think I'm just making something up, but let's just go with it. Talking about my makeup, not the story. And she actually used strychnine to kill her friend. After all of this time, Jane has still been keeping touch with her good old friend Elizabeth. Remember Elizabeth from the beginning? So Jane was actually on vacation in Cape Cod and she got a hold of Elizabeth and she was like, hey, why don't you come down to Cape Cod and join me and we'll vacation together? So of course Elizabeth was like, yeah, let's catch up. It's been a while. So this is 1899 and they had been talking, and I'm pretty sure there was one source that said that Elizabeth had expressed to Jane that she was depressed. So that is why Jane recommended that she go on vacation with her. They went to the beach together. They had a picnic with corned beef, taffy, and mineral water. But not just any mineral water. No, this was special mineral water with strychnine. So Jane made Elizabeth's death like long and very slow. I mean, I'm sure Elizabeth thought that they were friends, but I feel like this whole time Jane was just jealous because she was constantly reminded of how much lower she was than their family. And later on, Jane actually said, and I quote, "I held her in my arms and watched with delight as she gasped her life out." So she very much enjoyed killing Elizabeth. Now remember whenever I mentioned that Elizabeth had married a church deacon? Well, this man's name was Oramel Brigham, and Jane wanted him to marry her. Now I'm sure that growing up, Jane just wanted everything that Elizabeth had and was jealous of her, and that's why after getting rid of Jane, she just wanted her husband. So she actually started staying with him, and she ended up killing, within 3 days, she killed his 77-year-old housekeeper named Edna. So Jane ended up taking Edna's job as the housekeeper, and she was trying to make Oramel fall in love with her. But he made it clear that he did not want her as a wife. He didn't want her there at all. So she made another attempt for him to fall in love with her by slowly poisoning him and then nursing him back to health. Like she was this great nurse that saved his life. And she was hoping that then, for sure, he would be in love with her and want to marry her then. But no, he still was not interested in having her around or marrying her or anything. Whenever he was not being tricked into marrying her, she told him that she was going to tell everyone that she was pregnant and that he was the baby daddy. And that was like the final straw for Oramel, because this guy's a church deacon. He has a reputation, and he cannot have rumors going around of how he got someone pregnant. I hate how this is turning out, but whatever. So he kicked her out of his house, and whenever he kicked her out, she injected herself with morphine and tried to make it look like she was committing suicide. So she was actually in the hospital because this looked like an attempted suicide, but really it was just her being manipulative and just trying one last thing to have him marry her. In 1901, she rented out a cottage from the Davis family, but Jane did not pay her rent and she was actually in debt to this family. Alden Davis was the one who owned the house and the cottage and everything, along with his wife, Maddie. She was in debt to them and she wasn't paying rent or anything. And Maddie was like, you know what, let me just go and talk to her, see if I can get the money from her, because this was like another little building or home that they had on their property. So Maddie went over to talk to Jane and to get the rent from her. And Jane was just being Jane, was talking her way out of it. And then she invited Maddie in to have some mineral water. And when I say mineral water, by now we all know where this is going. She actually poisoned Maddie. Then Jane told Alden that she would take care of him. And whenever she was taking care of him, I mean, she did take care of him, kind of, and just in like a different way. She killed him. After she killed the parents, she went after their two of their daughters that were married. She killed Geraldine, which was one of their daughters. And whenever Geraldine died, now she wasn't elderly like all of her other victims had been. Geraldine was younger, and Jane actually tried to blame it on the fact that Geraldine was suicidal. Anytime anyone asked, Jane would just tell them how she had seen her threaten with her life and tried to kill herself and stuff. So everyone just thought, oh, you know, like her parents just died, she was probably just going through something and decided to end her life. But no, it was just Jane. And then Jane actually went after another one of their daughters named Minnie. And Minnie was married. So when Minnie died suddenly, Minnie's father-in-law was like, sus. The entire family was perfectly healthy. They were happy. I mean, this guy knew the family. He was like, they were healthy and happy. They would not, Geraldine wouldn't just commit suicide. Like, they wouldn't just die. He was on to Jane. Now, one source actually said that the father-in-law witnessed Jane standing over Minnie and injecting her with whatever she used to kill her. But then other sources say that he was just super skeptical. I feel like anyone would be in this case. So then the father-in-law consulted a toxicologist, and then together they got a judge to order the bodies exhumed, which showed that they all died from morphine and atropine poisoning. On October 29th, 1901, Jane was arrested. So while she was in jail waiting for her trial, she actually decided she wanted to be an author, and so she started writing books. When she finally did go to court, she wore her nurse's outfit just to show everyone, oh no, I would never hurt anyone. I'm a nurse. I was just doing my job and taking care of them, and they died. The trial lasted 8 hours. And then after the jury got together, it only took them 27 minutes to say that she was not guilty due to being insane. She was ruled not guilty because of insanity. This really does not look great, but whatever. Jane had to be examined by a psychiatrist, and I'm pretty sure that that's what made it to where she was just ruled insane. And in court, she also told them that she had a fear of corpses. How could she kill that many people? She was afraid of dead people. Whenever she received her verdict, she laughed. So, you know, that just kind of further made them think that she was insane. She actually admitted to her lawyer to killing 31 people. They believe that she killed at least 100, maybe. She could remember exactly 31, like everything about 31 of the people that she killed, like their names and how she did it and all of that kind of stuff. This is a quote. If I had been a married woman, I probably would not have killed all those people. I would have had my husband, my children, and my home to take up my mind. Sorry, my battery's about to die and I just wanted to cut the camera and finish eyeliner and lashes and all that, but I am back and I'm gonna do lips. So basically, this girl was saying that she was bored and she was like, if I had a husband and children, then I wouldn't have killed anybody. I have very strong feelings that that is not true because this girl killed so many people. She obviously loved it. She actually spent the rest of her days at Taunton State Hospital, and she died at the age of 81 from pneumonia on August 17th, 1938. Let me get some of these lips filled real quick. I feel like I always rush my lips too much and then they always look crazy in my videos, so that's fun. The attendants that took care of her at the state hospital said that she would call them into her room and she would smile at them. And this is a direct quote. She would say, "Get some morphine, dearie. We'll go out in the ward. You and I will have a lot of fun seeing them die." And that, my friends, is what I'm going to leave you with. So this chick was truly messed up and addicted to killing people. That is it for this week's Freaky Friday episode, or as I like to call it, behind the scenes, F'd Up Friday. My mom watches this, so I'm not gonna call it that. Anyways, please don't leave without liking this video because I like it when you like it, and also hit the button down below to subscribe to my channel and join the family if you like this stuff as much as I do. And if you like makeup, then you should probably stick around. Sorry, I took a shower today and my hair is just absolutely insane. Don't forget to follow me on all of my social medias. It is just Shelly G MUA on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok, but not on Snapchat. On Snapchat, it is something different. You can follow me on Instagram if you want to see my makeup looks without having to hear me talk. So this is goodbye for today. You know, shout out to the nurses that don't kill people and that actually do their job and take care of people. You're doing great. Keep going, especially during this time. You're doing amazing, sweetie. And for those of you who are now scared to go to the hospital and be taken care of by a nurse, I'm sorry, it's not my fault, it's Jane's fault. Anyway, I will see you later. God bless. Love you, bye.